Well, I would like to do with you a sort of a review. I hope I can do it short. I will say when I'm start, let's see who stops me, but he will. about what's going on in the water and land and livelihood context, scene, cases in Latin America. A question, I have everything in Spanish, but perhaps it is not so useful to show that. I can just talk about it. So I don't have to turn around and put my finger on the wrong button. So if it's no problem for you, I can leave it, or if you want to, we pass by.
Does it help you to have the slides? You have some photos and things like that.
The photos we will see, of course.
Yeah. Some of us speak Spanish,
okay,
and we're learning, so it's good training for
everyone.
But with, you know, with the pictures and what you'll tell us.
Oh, the pictures I would like to share with you, of course, because that gives a view on what words can't explain sufficiently.
Yeah, thank you.
Yes, okay, well, last 10, 12 years, I do my work in Peru, in the southern part of Peru, but connect to the whole Andean region, even exchange with other researchers and case studies in Mexico. And I'm part of a broader platform, Alliance, which is called Water Justice. You can find it with the same word, and also in Spanish, Justicia Hídrica, in the website. There you can find all the publications and things which give much more development of what I tried to share with you. And probably you know a lot about it even, because it's not only a Latin American context, it's a worldwide context. But perhaps what I feel that in the last 15 years, in Latin America it went very fast. A complete transformation of land, access to water, transformations of livelihood in rural areas, fast-growing cities, of course, influencing in the relations between urban and rural relations and watersheds. So what I want to share with you is a short context of what's going on, and then see what are the actors, and a little bit about what are those ideas behind this. And there are different ways to look at it, more on a ideological discourse way, and also on a more on a analytic economic way, on which I use some views and research of David Harvey, also of Wellerstein, and even of the French, not so much the same, but even though economist, Liquet. Well, let's start. what we found a little bit as a resume to share is what's happening with land, water, and living, livelihoods and people. There's a process going on, very, very quick, and very hard also, of accumulation, but by disposal. It's not an accumulation as such, it's not free. If you accumulate, you have to, in this way, on big investments, you have to get rid of others. At the disposal, despojo. That gives, of course, a big development and presence of conflicts. I can even tell you that in the last 15 years, even more the last 5 years, the registration of conflicts, by example in Peru, went exponentially high. It's not a soft line. It goes up very quickly with the way of how the territory is occupied by new big companies, big sectors. We will see what are those, not only the mining sector, but it's a very strong one. Those conflicts, they bring up, of course, different strategies of control or two strategies to go on from conflict to resistance and somehow, sometimes, to proposal. So that means that the third big part is the action, the actors of the social civil society, or mostly of those communities, indigenous people, small farmer communities, somehow peripherical urban barrios,
neighborhoods,
do they, because of conflicts and a very asymmetric power relations, who get together and try to make some movement and some protest or even alternatives about that. So let's have a look over that. What is it all about? It has got a lot of... I take my own copy because my eyes aren't so well as before. That sometimes happens. It deals with a lot of things, really a lot of things. It's a very complex situation, context, cases, examples, etc., etc., and processes going on. Let's see. In the first place, when I look at the water sector on hydrological aspects, even hydraulic aspects of that, we can see that water conflicts, water access to water doesn't go alone. It's always linked to land, territorial, and ecosystems. You can't look at as water on a more hydrological way. It's impossible. And even in the territorial ecosystem relations, you will see quite quickly that it goes about livelihood. Livelihood in a way related to a new opening of territory for big investment. That's the thing what's going on in the whole Latin American countries from the north to the south. You can say from even the Central American, Mexico, Central American, then going down to Chile. Chile is a very strong example because after the Pinochet regime and dictatorial period, it's the only country who really, really privatized water. Water is private property. You can buy, you can sell, you can use or not use, and there's a market. And it went so high, those prices, that even the government couldn't buy it back. It's impossible. They have to see how to arrange new situations of enormous disequalities.
Inequalities
between havers and have-nots. Well, so if we recognize this, then the first thing that comes always up is this: the way of water rights, land rights, social rights, cultural rights, human rights, and the whole bunch of rights which go into the struggle about access to water and land. And that's a quite different and unequal also process, because new investment is a thing of the last 30 years, and moreover the last 15 years, very hard, very quick. There are areas, departments, which are mining, by example, mining concessions in the old Andean zone, the Pacific, and then the Amazon, got other processes, but that go that quick that there are departments who are with concessions of their land more than 60%. Others, the medium size of the whole Peru situation is 25%. That is a medium. So you can imagine how low and how high in other situations. The southern part grows very quickly. It was first of all the northern part, Cajamarca, the well-known conflicts about the Yanacocha Newmont mine, Nowadays it went downstairs, down south, Apurimac, Cusco, Puno, Arequipa, Tacna, Moquegua, all those regions, they are occupied by new mining concessions. Not only mining, we will see that's also trying to get to the model the Amazon. They are planning a lot of 25 more or less new hydropower installations, but really big. It's not a small one. There's one in the southern part which is planned for a reservoir for 450 square kilometers. We are wondering now, is it for water, for energy, or is it a water regulation? It's an amusing, a water regulation reservoir for the near frontier of Brazil. Things like that. They don't discuss it, but it comes up. So there are different types of water rights, of course. So you can find in the local communities a historical, large, let's say, history of and practice of customary rights, we can say that. And you can find that in the video I left on your table, the bigger one, about how does customary rights function in a social community. There are Andean principles you can find in every place, but each community, each smaller watershed management group, they construct their own rights. It's not written. It's a process of historical construction and also adaption and also of inequality. It's not always a paradise, of course not. It's also an internal struggle and between different communities. But it goes about different kinds of understanding about rights and legitimate use and how to solve it or how to construct it. It's not only access to water. The water rights goes to organization, to elections, to how to distribute, to how to capture water and also get it out of your area. What do you have to do each other together and also with others? How to struggle about it? How to make sanctions about it or ceremonies? It's a very big world, cultural world about water rights and land rights. It's not like the governmental administration said, you can get a paper of it, and that is registration of your water rights. And all those customary rights have to be formalized. Formalized is to say, to put in the official formal administration policy and mechanisms. And those whole processes of formalization change, destruct somehow all those customary rights. So people with new laws, they got to know more than 300 articles to know what the hell is going on with the water rights. And that is quite impossible. So the decision about what has to be formalized is a public formal governmental question. And the people doesn't know exactly what happened, and they don't know often how to defend also their own rights. Because the article in the law, they say, it's Article 64, they say, the government recognize local customary rights. Their way of understanding of the recognition is a transformation, a formalization, and generate a lot of conflicts. Because those people had to be normalized, not only formalized, they have to be normalized, they're abnormal. So those communities far away from central governmental Lima, they are not well known, so there is one or two or three or a whole team who make new rules for them. Anybody who will ask for how do they do the things, it's not done. So it's in one way action. That means that nobody really in the administration about water knows what are customary rights. They don't study it, they don't consider it interesting also to do so. A lot to do about water rights and land rights, because the new income mining, water transfer from one watershed to other, because agribusiness, hydropower, big, fast-growing cities, they got always a priority. If the law says that it's different, in the practice it doesn't function that way. That means that a mining company can have with this concession in 3 weeks these water rights. A community, it takes from 3 months to 3 years. There's a lot of effort, a lot of money, a lot of headache, and a lot of problems generated of that process. By the way, working with them, we always said, well, before you ask your formal licenses or rights of water, and to formalize it, try to formalize yourself first. Make it clear inside the community and with your neighbors. Try to resolve all those kinds of conflicts and problems, and then make your rights clear, and you go to the administration and say, I want my water rights, and I want them dead, this way, not another way. And then you will start, or probably, a negotiation process, because the government never does what you want. Let's see. It's a very large story about water rights, waters as such. What's going on? It's going on a very asymmetric situation about power and influence. Local people, local communities, historically colonized, or whatever you say so, started up with a conquista and a colony, Spanish colonization process. It went on the same way in the Republican period, and then in the late 60s with the land reform, there was a sort of a period of slowing down all those processes of big haciendas and land owners to smaller communities. Then they came up with cooperatives, different kinds, didn't function sufficiently, it was too much designed top down, and then it separated themselves again, and then came a new period of land concentration, very, very quick. On the coastal area, which is a small strip to the Pacific Ocean, with 54 watersheds going from the Andean region to the sea, they concentrate nowadays in the south and northern part agribusiness. And it goes very quick. It aren't haciendas, it aren't agriculture. These are financial corporations. They accumulate land. I give you an example about the financial group of Gloria, which is not only Leche Gloria, Mill Gloria, no, it's land. They got together buying and also getting grip of in less than 15 years, 120,000 hectares. That's some of it, no? Isn't it? So it's a small thing. So they control for sugarcane and ethanol biofuel, they control in the coastal area 120,000 hectares as a financial corporation for investment and capital income and control of the whole area. You can imagine that 120, 100 or even 50,000 hectares means that the land is managed by others, not even the government, not even the local people. They don't decide anymore about their neighborhoods or something like that, municipalities even. So that means that the new access to water in that area also is managed by a financial corporation and these agribusiness farms. In the southern part, it's asparagus.
Asparagus?
Yes, that is. Oh. Export.
Yeah, asparagus exports. Yeah.
And in the northern part, it could be also bananas, but more or less it's the export of industrial products, and in this case, a lot of sugarcane for biofuel. Well, that means that the whole area is managed by others, with other interests, with other power, with other view with other knowledge and with other forms of, yeah, let's say, it's even an other culture. You can find different cultures, or a governmental culture, an enterprise investment culture, a urban culture, a small or medium farmers culture, a local community culture, all those that are different worlds, quite different. However, the governmental culture and state or public sector in this case goes very near with the new investment groups, because the new model is that neoliberal, you can call it how it comes out, but it's a way of opening land after since 30 years, even more, opening land for new investment. And they always say the country and the territory has to be open for any kind of investments, and if there's a problem of conflict, environmental damage, things like conflict, social environmental conflicts, the answer is you pay for it. You just pay. Pay the people, pay the government, pay the sanction. So it should be open for everything. That's the view behind everything. It sounds very strange, but it isn't. It works that way. So the power and the influence of investment groups make it quite easy to to capture governments. You can call it really capturing, because not only the influence, they get control of it. And that's not one-way thinking, it's two-way thinking also, because you remember that the last 30, 40 years, the international, the US governments, they are too incapacitated, they don't have the capacity to govern, they are corrupt, they don't have money enough, you have to shrink down or diminish the whole public sector, and market principles, they take over. Well, they did, but not just for free. So the governmental capacity went down. They just get to have norms, policies, and legislation in function of this occupying mechanism. So in politics, in norms, in laws, in their own construction of an institutionality of governmental management, and even though with their own budget, investments, facilitation, there are a lot of projects with international investment, but also with a lot of state money, people's tax money, to facilitate the entrance of international and national investments. And that means that the whole image for the people of government, it's always very, with a lot of distrust, with a lot of bad experience, even though they elect them even each 5 years the same. Always they think, well, perhaps there could be had to some change, but well, the analyze goal doesn't go so far. And that means that if you review all those inquestas or the studies about opinion studies, you can find a startup with a new government on more or less 35-40%, and then during really short time it goes down to 20, and it ends up between 5, 7, 10, or 12%, and that's always going that way. So the whole legitimacy of governments goes down with the capturing of the government as such. Well, let's go. That means also that the capacity to govern land, to govern territorial and people, ecosystems and all that, is not so important for governments. That's the idea, is that the new incomers, they will do it better than they can. Well, that's just a discourse. and the weakness of knowing what's going on is very high. Those who know much better than what's happening in the country and in their area are the own investment groups. They don't start without knowledge. They start with a very good study, got very much more information than the whole government. They know exactly how water and land is going on in their concession area. Even local people don't know that, or don't have the access to that. One time we presented in a regional situation with farmers, communities, and local municipality, we presented a map of what is going on with mining concessions. They didn't know. And they were that astonished that they were sitting on a mining concession. And that means a lot of trouble, because the mining concession needs formally a social acceptance. Well, it's not a consulting for that is, let's say, vinculante. When the community says we don't want it, it doesn't mean that it won't go. It won't go. It goes anyway, anyhow. So it's just a opinion going on, and a new law about the previous consulting for obligation. They diminished it during 5 years to something which doesn't exist almost anymore. However, the international protocols and convenience, they OIT 169, things like that, international UNDP agreements, they just put them that way that it doesn't function so much. So if it's that size, the government, it can bring it down to this. Okay, let's go more. That's what it definitely is, I think. okay, so a lot of economy, local economy, is transformed and influenced by a bigger extractive economy. So what somehow is paid for taxes or canon minero is sort of a tax for reinvestment in the area, doesn't have so much effect in the whole local in the whole benefits for people, because it's changed the local economy, and the prices go up. There's this very small group which get some benefits out of it, moreover services and commercial, but the local people, the local communities, they go down because it's very it's not cheap anymore. No, cheap is not the word. It's very difficult for them to cope with all those prices which go up, transport, even services, even food and things like that. So you get a sort of an enclave, a sort of a small colony of mining or each kind of concession, and people outside, they empower it more. Impoverishment, you say, I think. So the whole landscape, and also what we could call waterscape, which is a little bit more than a watershed. It's the nature, the paisaje hídrico, yeah. It's like a landscape where you see the different forms of activities, dynamics around land and water. So that changed. It changed a lot. It's transformed. So people live in a new world, if they live still over there. So that gives a strong separation effect, a dividing effect. Because those in the community, this community, half of it say it's a good thing, let's go for the mining. They will give us work, there will be money, we can negotiate land and things like this. And the other part of the community said, we're not sure about that. We don't want it. We have seen what happened in other places. We don't want this concession here. So the whole community is split up, even families. father, mother, children. A lot of younger ones say, let's go for the mining, a little bit of money, and perhaps I can learn a little bit more, because they offer some scholarship for how to manage big trucks. So a whole social network, a society, is little by little destructed and very difficult to recover if they consider that it wasn't the idea what is going on. So the whole concept of development, wow, that word that is used, Peru needs this mining development because they got money and they redistribute it and they have it for benefits of the people. Well, benefits, it's very difficult to see. It's a benefit of a huge, yeah, let's say, new group of money makers about that. You can see in Lima if it's the same thing as in any big, rich country. And on the other side, you can see all the ones who doesn't benefit of it, and they get excluded. And don't let them hear their voice, because that is against the development model, and they aren't not, almost not Peruvians. They are strange people who are against the development of the country. So if they have a protest, that we will see also, the international market get the whole influence also. But if the civil society, local groups, even local governments or real governments, go against it, they're criminalized, you can say. So they are always looked at violent, people who don't agree, they are traditional, outcasts, and moreover discriminated. Because it goes together with Indian people, indigenous people, those poor ones. That means they aren't seen as equalized Peruvians who benefit from this model. Even though when the land and the small farmers, family and community agriculture is still going on. And it still gives 60% of the food in the country. It still employs 70% of the people in rural area. However, those investments and support or policies with the budget goes the last 30 years in this line. It doesn't come up. It doesn't go up. Very small sometimes, while the rest of the budget goes this way. So you got differences between the agrarian small-scale sector and, by example, urban sector, difference of budgets for more than 1,000 times. Okay. The discourses, civil society, ping. Yeah. The discourses, they still go on about the big benefits of it. And it is incredible how that dominates also the problems. The conflicts go up very fast. There's one institution in the country, La Defensoría del Pueblo, the People's Defense Unit. It's governmental, but it's quite independent, like Ombudsman, you can say that. And they study conflicts over time. The last 3 months, 4 months, we can find more than 90 conflicts going on, not new, not old, going on. New and going on conflicts. However, 80% of these conflicts are with the mining sector, not only metallic, also oil and hydropower conflicts, contamination, land occupation, disposition, protest, control, repression. Repression goes always in favor of the company. The company has got a very fine strategies of control on local area. If the concession is this big, their control of the area, they got a sort of a buffer zone which is a social control this big, and then you've got one circle around more big, that's their influence. So little by little, a lot of concessions. Peru doesn't have any sovereignty anymore. They sold their country out. If we look shortly to the map of the Peruvian Amazon, it's occupied by concessions for more than 70%. So more, almost three quarters of the Peruvian Amazon is concessed to no more than 14 international oil companies. Well, what that means is a very, very unequal problem, where local Amazon indigenous communities are completely splashed down. Somehow there are organizations and movements that try to defend or even to demonstrate all that oil spoiling which is going on. There isn't any mine and any oil company in the whole world even, but in this country even more, which not contaminate. Everything contaminate. It's even the mining engineer can tell us that. But the way of how to do it and on what dimension and on by what laws and control, that differs a lot from other parts of the world, or at least for Europe or North America. So the South has other laws and other, let's say, space for what they call extractivism and getting out things, even with small economic development on very local size. The country as such didn't has so much of real human sustainable environmental development. You can imagine what happens, we can see the photos, what happens with the different natures. Also the problem with alimentation and health. There are even places in Peru where the children are called the plump children. They got too many plump in their blood. Health problems are normally not recognized, but they're present in any way. Bad water is still used. The real treatment of water for water use, domestic water use, can go on more, let's say, urbanized areas, but not for everybody. So in the countryside, you have to do the water there is. So it's not strange that there are really strong health problems in areas, in mining areas. Okay. Knowledge information. what I was told, who gets the knowledge over this, all these things, and how to put it in the agenda? There are no more than, two or one and a half universities in Peru who study somehow these problems. There's the Catholic University in Lima, a very moneyful one, not cheap, and in Cusco a little bit, the public university. Nobody studies these things. There are only some NGOs. And somehow, or sometimes, a little bit, the international cooperation, who finance somehow some case studies, or in time more a articulated research pattern. So these business, they got the knowledge, they study very good, they got a lot of technology to know where to mine and how, and that's also a very important bias, because if you don't know what's happening on, where do you protest for? It's more an emotional or an existential way, but you don't have the data and the information to negotiate about that. I remember one conflict near Cusco. The government did some studies, but each sector did a different study one. The water sector, the mining sector, the health sector, the environmental sector. There were more than 6 reports about health and social conflict situation. Each of them was different. They weren't able to get it together and to have a real view of what's going on. And then 2 years later, the health report came out and everybody was astonished because it didn't publish it before. And then they knew really what's going on with health in the mining area. Okay, what's it all about? What are the actors also? There's another one. I will pass them very quickly, put some of them here, and then we'll see. By example, the agribusiness and exportation sector. It grew very, very fast. That is what I mentioned before with the financial group of Gloria. There are more of 12 big financial groups who get in the agriculture and land and mining sector to have more benefits on capital investment. And that can go very high. If you've got a good mining function there, your netto income can grow more than 100-200%. I learned a lot of years before that a good project with benefit cost and internal rate of return was a little bit more than a banking rate. Well, nowadays it's a little bit more, of course, because of the low capital rates, but 50%, good project, investments can do. These investments go far beyond, and on a netto base also. So it's good making money of it, and we will see why they have to, or want to make money out of it, not only by a capital investment view. Okay, we find agribusiness, agro-industrial, biofuel, we find mining consortiums, which dominate more or less the whole conflict situation, also with water, oil, petrol, gas, hydro energy. From north to south, it's planned to have 25 big hydropower installations, more than we now have. There isn't any idea about how many energy Peru needs and if there's a deficit or not. So they say, we do it because we can sell. We can sell energy to Brazil. But Brazil has got also its own hydropower installation, all somehow and sometimes in the same watershed. So that was the question that we were asking us. This hydropower installation, is that really for energy? Is it for regulating water? If the flow is downwards in Brazil and they have to close 2 or 3 hydropower stations? Interesting question. Okay, also the accumulated function of illegal Amazon wood timber is the word, yeah. There is almost no wood, no timber going out of Peru, which is legal. It's almost 90% illegal, even with all those international regulations and as such. So that means also somehow how the control works. But also, 5 minutes. But also the thing about food industry, international, water bottling, commerce, virtual water is also the term, which goes out of the country and never comes back in this way. Of course, also big projects, urban development is an important thing. Let's leave it that way because it's a little bit boring to go through all those bad guys, however we feel it, bad guys, and the government says to us as an institute, no, you are the bad guys. You're against the development and you've got to very good look after. If not, we kick you out of the country. Well, a lot of protests finished also, not only in protest, but also death, a lot of people hurt, and a lot of, let's say, psychological go down of people believing in what to do with their lives and with the for the future generation. Climate change, okay, it's also a problem. But it comes up as a pressure on the same problem. So there are some, I remember the discussion with the Southern Peru Copper Corporation in Tacna, Moquegua. They said there's no any problem in this, we do not don't have any problem in this watershed. We're pumping out, but there's no problem, there's sufficient groundwater. The problem is climate change. So you just transfer the inequality and the bad distribution to a national climate change problem, which always is not generated on local level. Well, I wanted to finish with something that Mr. Rockefeller told once. It's interesting to see that in the 19th century, the first groups which got together, families, to control the whole oil industry was around Rockefeller's, not the only one. Banks, Citibank, I've got the names here. And they went on in history to new groups of controlling. And how are they thinking about the control of the world? I got some visions out of an interesting study of Mr. Esteban Cabral. The Spanish one, yeah, let's go fast. That is, oh yeah, let's see, let's have some images. You see on the left side, how was the occupation of oil companies' concessions in Peru in 2008, I think?
Four.
And then going up to the right to 2008, I think.
Six, two years.
In 2 years you can see how it changed. So that means also that all those indigenous communities over there are blocking the development of Peru. They are seen as also people who block, you say it in Spanish, el perro del hortelano, no? He doesn't eat and he won't let eat to others also. So the president called these indigenous people perro del hortelano, because their country, their zone had to be opened for investment. Well, it wasn't an interesting map, it must be worse now. That means oil spoiling in every exploitation occurs. And it has, it is a very fine strategy to tap things. But it still goes on. The last conflict was in Iquitos about derrame, in the derrame.
Spill.
Thank you, yeah. Spill, which the government said, no, nothing has happened. The company says that nothing has happened. 2 months later, they had to recognize an awful spilling, which wasn't known until that moment. And they started to say, okay, let's have some repairing, paying the people, but it's impossible to repair these amounts of oil in the jungle. These are mines in towns. So the mining grows and the city has got to move away. That's one thing. Open mining looks like this. And then the conception about mining concession is private property. It isn't private property, but they put it over there. They put this bar over there with a small house for the people to control, and there's nobody here. And you can't go any way around. It's a symbol. The symbol of private property as a concession as private property. But they pump a lot of water outside, downwards from subterranean water amounts to transpass to other places for the whole process of mining and well, the process of getting somehow raw material out of it. You need a lot of water. So they dried up the whole higher part of this watershed which goes down until people really got mad and they cut the pipelines out of broken the pipelines. And then the police came in. They were arrested. They got in jail, and everything in the mining just goes on. That is how it goes. Huge areas of challenged landscapes, which is for food, for animal husbandry, for pasture, more than 2,000 hectares, is slowly abandoned because the water was cut off at the higher parts for mining. This is still the Southern Peru Copper Corporation. There's also other kind of mining, of course. There's artisanal small-scale mining, which isn't much better, but it's much, well, not better. It's on a small scale, and a lot of people in the community say, why do we wait until the big company comes? We start ourselves. And then there are some companies who say, okay, I'll help you. I'll give you part of my concession, or I will come up with some machinery, and we do it 30-70. 70 for me, 30 for you. Very big water reservoirs for energy. What can I say about that? Well, it's always sold like a neutral, no consumptional, clean energy. Well, we know, of course, and not only we, also the international thinking group on dams, they know quite well that it isn't true. It means even a lot of intervention of river morphology. The whole system of a river is changed, but also the whole ecology around and ecosystem around it changed. Temperature is changed. The inundated vegetation below, bushes, forest, goes in a process of methane production, and there is a lot of people disposition and getting out of the area, which is in terms of economy quite negative if you calculate everything going on. If you just calculate the energy price as a benefit and the cost of the construction, then you are almost on 10% of your calculation. They call that externalidades, no? External costs not calculated. Let's see. And this is what happened when there is protest. It is still, it sounds very, very bad, but it is still going on that you can shoot on Indian people. Normally. They don't have the same human value as those people in Lima or in big cities. I remember the title of a film, a movie, it's what they shoot horses, don't they? Well, they shoot Indians, don't they? Well, agribusiness also, these are somehow in the desert, the southern part of Lima, in the desert, big companies start to buy land or to have land because there wasn't any price on desert. They put aquifer pumping wells that make them private almost because they don't have to deal with nobody. It's your well. And they lowered more or less from 20 meters below level to 160 meters below. So all the groundwater was and is still going on. Then they started to think that it would be an end of it. All those wells which were on 20 meters, they were hanged. They didn't have any more to do. So also drink water for local townships, they couldn't get more of the groundwater for domestic use. And now they are starting to talk about some watershed management which should have the possibility to recharge. But the main thing is, get your money out of this business, of course. Okay, this means also, this is in Lima, That means also on the Pueblos Jóvenes, they call it, was a very euphemistic name. Young villages, huh? They don't get the water. They have to buy it from a tank, and that costs 10 times higher than the water costs in the most richest neighborhood of Lima, Miraflores or La Molina. And they don't have really clean water, and they don't have sanitation, of course. So that's another way of living in these areas. Well, here they decide about the law and the water. It's the parliament, the Congress, who approved a new water law in 2009. In this scenery, they approved, you won't believe me, you know in how many time they approved this law? 15 minutes. Then the water law was approved. Without any discussion before. Well, I can tell you a lot about how this law got on the way. Well, what I wanted to show you is this, and then, I won't take more time about that. I just can tell you what's the thinking about a new model of controlling everything of natural resources in the world. The societies, they will be dominated by small groups of technicians and financiers who are free of values and social values and cultural values, and they aren't afraid of putting in some mechanisms to control natural resources and people. Because the purpose is not only control natural resources and land, but you got to control also the consumers. And that's the thing what they thought about more than 15, 20 years before. Okay. David Harvey's got his own analysis of that. He says, when you accumulate so much capital, you got a overproduction of capital. That's dangerous, because that makes that capital devaluated. So you got to reinvest, or you got to destroy capital. The best way for destroying capital is war. And another way to reinvest overvalue of capital is to go to land buying or natural resource accumulation. Because industrial transformation is very difficult to do in a few years. New markets to create takes a long time, it's very risky. So you better go to the southern part of the world and get the best natural resources out. There's a lot more to say about that, but that's in synthesis. Why does this happen? Or are we all nuts that this is the best way to manage this world? I leave it this way.